Hello, and welcome to today's episode on splicing. In this video, I'll cover everything you'll need to know about splicing to effectively annotate genes. My name is Christina Ray Santos. I'm a TA for the Genomics Education Partnership, and you are watching a GEP tutorial. Outlined are the timestamps for each of the major topics I'll be going over today, including a conceptual overview of splicing, the standard anatomy of a gene, interpreting reading frames and phases, and alternative splicing. So, without further ado, let's dive in. If you've taken at least one biology class, you ought to know the central dogma of biology, which describes the general idea of how our blueprints come to life and can be summed up into three major steps: replication, transcription, and translation. While it's important to be familiar with all of them, this video will specifically focus on splicing, which generally occurs in the nucleus following transcription. Splicing is the process in which genes' introns get excised or removed, leaving just the exons. Once processed, ribosomes can then use them to construct their corresponding proteins. Each of the three steps are associated with each of the three products, DNA, RNA, and protein, respectively. DNA is replicated, transcribed into RNA, spliced to create messenger RNA, which then gets translated into proteins. This is the central dogma of biology. Now, before we get in too deep, let's cover the basic anatomy of genes that you'll need to be familiar with in order to best understand splicing in the context of gene annotation. Starting with which weighs which. In both the UCSC genome browser and in the simplified diagram above, this single strand would need to be read from left to right, or 5 prime to 3 prime. Like a stream of water, genes flow from upstream to downstream. Similarly, directionality is relative to your reference point. And we can orient ourselves by using our blast results, the arrows on the introns, hovering over the exons to get a feel for where you're at, comparing it to the fly-based model, or looking for the potential start and stop codons. In eukaryotes, the canonical start codon methionine is often crucial for initiating translation. The UCSC genome browser conveniently automatically highlights any potential start codons in bright green, while all of the possible stop codons are highlighted in bright red. These serve as potential signals for where to terminate translation. Here we can see that these two isoforms use different stop codons. In this case, isoform B on the bottom produces a longer transcript than isoform A, but the shorter and thus smaller protein of the two. The exons are indicated by the thickest boxes, which include both protein coding regions and untranslated regions. Nearly immediately after transcription, the RNA transcript undergoes splicing, in which some of it is cut out and the remaining transcript, or exons, are pasted together. The parts removed are more commonly known as introns, which can be identified by a line containing arrows pointing in the direction in which the gene is coherently read and expressed. The regions that actually get translated into protein are known as the coding DNA sequences, or CDS for short. Any exon that does not get translated into protein is known as the untranslated region, or UTR for short. A distinguishing characteristic of UTRs is the tapering off at the ends, which is due to having less overlapping reads. The part before the start codon is considered the 5' or upstream UTR, and the part after the stop codon is considered the 3' or downstream UTR. It should be noted that these are still considered exons because they end up in the transcript, but they are not considered CDSs because they aren't destined to code for amino acids. So, at this point, you may be thinking, well, if they don't code for any part of the protein, why would evolution have it so that they flank every transcript ever made? Well, as it turns out, single-stranded mRNA molecules are prone to quickly falling apart. To prevent it from degrading, mRNA has evolved to include specialized regions at the ends that recruit protective proteins, which binds to the UTRs, thus stabilizing the entire molecule. But wait, there's more. These regions also include instructions to specify where, when, and to what extent the transcript should be translated. In this way, they also serve as translation factors. It's also worth noting that some RNAs, like tRNA or rRNA, aren't meant to be translated into protein. Instead, they play structural and catalytic roles. In either case, the UTRs are crucial for proper cell function. Altogether, we can visualize the concept of basic gene structure and function. But remember that DNA is made up of two complementary anti-parallel strands. We often call them the top or positive and bottom or negative strands. But if you think about it, there isn't really any top or bottom strand, nor positive or negative when you're talking about DNA in the cell. It is merely standard for the sequence strand to be referred to as the positive sense strand, whereas the complement is referred to as the negative sense strand. Each amino acid is made from a combination of three bases that form one codon. So notice that if we start with adenine here, we get AGC, TTC, GAA, and so on, which codes for serine, phenylalanine, glutamine, and again so on. But if you start just one over, you get alanine, serine, lysine, etc. Since only one reading frame of the three is used to make the gene's protein, we must make sure that we're starting and ending at the correct nucleotides for our predicted models. Otherwise, one or two missing extra nucleotides can cause a frame shift, likely resulting in a truncated protein and nonsensical sequence and structure. There are a total of six possible reading frames between the two strands, but the UCSC Genome Browser will only show you one at a time, so make sure you're referring to the one you intend to. Also, take note that codons are generally referred to by their mRNA sequences, in which the thymines are switched with uracils, as depicted with the negative sense strand on the right. With 61 ways to code for 20 amino acids, one can only imagine the endless possibilities for genetic variation compacted into these complex structures made up of just four different building blocks. In this example, our gene of interest is on the negative strand. However, the default view of the reading frames is of the positive sense strand. So to view the negative sense reading frames, we can toggle the arrow at the top left corner of the window. Now, we are viewing the reading strand that makes sense for the gene of interest. We can also reverse this view if you're used to seeing the gene be read from left to right. If you notice that there's no start or stop codons where there should be, closed reading frames where you should have a coding region, no canonical motifs, or just some other reason it doesn't make sense, you may be viewing the incorrect strand for your gene. If you're not sure which strand your gene is on, clicking on the fly-based protein coding genes track for your gene will provide you with a basic breakdown of its structure, including its orientation. Okay, so you know how the genome browser displays each of the strand's three possible reading frames at a time, whether they're actually expressed that way or not? Well, a simple analysis of the potential reading frames can allow us to quickly infer how this gene is read. Let's try and predict which reading frames are used here. And note that it doesn't matter if there are potential stop codons in an intronic region because they don't make it to the process transcript. All right, so highlighted in red are the closed reading frames, which, if used, would result in premature stop codons and ultimately truncated proteins, which would be bad. Highlighted in green are the open reading frames, which are any that don't have a stop codon. Now, of all the possible open reading frames, which has a start and stop codon where we'd expect them to be? Recall that we need one to start the gene and one to end it. There's really only one choice.
Nice.
So you see, only one of the strands makes sense, while the other is like trying to read a book backwards and upside down. How crazy is it that we're alive because of our physical biological blueprints consisting of millions of nucleotides arranged anti-parallel and complementary to each other so that they can be opposite yet in harmony with each other, each with their own story to tell? If we zoom into any intron, chances are we'll find the canonical splice sites GT and AG at the upstream and downstream edges, respectively. We can see in the pictograph showing the general structure of various eukaryotic species introns that this is a pretty solid way to do it. But it's not the only way. Some atypical donor and acceptor sites can be seen here. If you come across what may seem to be a non-canonical splice site, remember to take the rest of your lines of evidence, like the gene record finder and RNA-seq, into consideration as well. Now let's apply our knowledge of reading frames to determine the phases. Step 1. Determine which reading frame your upstream exon uses. In this example, let's say it uses the +3 reading frame. Step 2. Determine the phase of the splice site donor. To do this, visualize a line dividing your predicted exon from the splice site donor. If a spliceosome were to cleave the transcript here, how many nucleotides of the interrupted codon would be left in the final transcript? That number is your donor phase. Step 3. To determine the phase of the acceptor, visualize a line dividing the splice site acceptor and the coding region. If the spliceosome were to cleave the transcript here, which reading frame would result in a complete codon if paired with the other end? That is the reading frame for your downstream exon. As you can see, the phases of the donor and acceptor must complement each other to make a complete codon consisting of 3 nucleotides. Otherwise, the sequence downstream would be shifted over 1 or 2 bases, likely creating a truncated and nonsensical protein. Because frameshift mutations are risky business, the spliceosome machinery relies heavily on canonical splice site factors to ensure the end product is as evolution intended. But, as Thomas Jefferson once said, with great risk comes great reward. Now, I don't think this is what he meant, but it still applies. A mutation might just save your life and future generations, or it could be the end of you and your bloodline. As I say, biology is the study of accepted and evolving exceptions. All right, so now that you're a bit more familiar with splicing, let's take a look at how it actually works. You don't really need to know a lot of the nitty-gritty details of the splicing mechanism to effectively annotate genes. However, it is a good idea to have at least some general concept of what happens. Let's use this example of a freshly transcribed molecule of pre-mRNA. If we were to zoom into an intron junction, we'd see something like this, with our canonical splice site donor, GU, at the 5' end of the intron, and the acceptor, AG, at the 3' end. Most eukaryotes utilize a protein complex called the spliceosome, which is made up of small nuclear ribonucleoproteins, also known as SNRNPs, also known as SNRPs. For this live action, just imagine my fingers are the SNRPs and my hands make up the spliceosome, which will assist in cleaving and positioning the transcript in such a way that the branch point nucleotide, which is generally an adenosine, initiates a nucleophilic attack on the donor, forming the Laria intermediate. The spliceosome machinery then brings the downstream exon close enough for the exposed end to perform another nucleophilic attack on the first nucleotide of the downstream exon, ligating the two together. The result is an intron Laria, which the cell will break down and repurpose, and a growing mRNA transcript made of exons and the UTRs. And of course, this goes on for each splice junction until we have a single coherent transcript for further processing. Easy peasy, am I right? You know what they say. There's more than one way to splice a gene, or whatever that saying about eggs is. Alternative splicing is an energy-efficient way for multicellular organisms to modulate cellular differentiation and is largely responsible for the diversity we see throughout biology. Constitutive splicing uses all of the exons and none of the introns. Any other pattern of splicing is referred to as alternative splicing, which can be categorized into three major classifications. Alternative 3' splicing uses an alternative splice site acceptor, and alternative 5' splicing uses an alternative splice site donor, resulting in either more or less of an exon included in the final transcript. We also have exon or intron exclusion, which is pretty much exactly what it sounds like, so we'll just leave it at that. And then we have intron retention, which is an intron that is not spliced out and remains in the transcript. As you can see, alternative splicing provides the opportunity for various proteins to be produced from just one gene. Doing things out of the ordinary can yield extraordinary results, like isoforms. Just look at all those exceptions. This one sequence of DNA is capable of producing 5 different versions of the same gene, isoforms A through E. When there is enough evidence to support an alternate transcript being produced, that is when we call it an isoform of that gene. When we're talking about isoforms, we're probably referring to either the RNA transcript or its resulting protein. Transcripts will be referred to by their gene symbol, R, and then the isoform, while the protein will be referred to by the same, but with a P for protein instead of R for RNA. Let's recall the central dogma of biology. We go from DNA to RNA to protein, right? Well, this illustrates the RNA to protein part. Let's imagine this gene is some sort of transmembrane protein that acts as a multi-step relay of some sort. If we were to use an alternate splice donor or acceptor for the second intron, we might end up with a different version of the receptor, specially adapted to only do half the job. We could also use alternative splice site acceptors or donors for the first intron to get a completely dysfunctional protein incapable of recognizing or even relaying any stimuli. Perhaps these isoforms play a role in blocking the stimuli instead. Now, this is just a random example I came up with, but hopefully you get the idea. Phew. All right. I know this was a lot of information to take in, so let's do a quick recap. DNA gets transcribed into pre-mRNA, which still contains introns until the spliceosome is recruited to facilitate splicing at each splice site using a series of nucleophilic attacks and transesterifications. The mRNA molecule containing the exons can then be reverse transcribed into a more stable double-stranded version, amplified, and then aligned against the genomic DNA. Since these no longer contain introns, we ought to see a drop in reads indicating where the introns are located within the gene. This tool, known as RNA-seq, allows us to visualize what regions of genomic DNA are being transcribed, how much is being expressed, as well as where and when. We can attribute much of our ability to adapt and develop throughout generations and conditions that may change by the minute to alternative splicing. The majority of genes are designed to produce alternative transcripts, which can be found in various cell types, tissues, organs, life stages, sexes, conditions, phenotypes, and species. Just think of all that biodiversity. And it's almost all thanks to splicing. And that's all, folks. Thank you so much for watching. If you found this video to be helpful, check out our YouTube channel for more GEP tutorials.